to get rid of the stress from our dogs, whatever they are that experience, we have to provide structure. This isn't like a blanket structure thing. This isn't just like, whew, it's like throwing the blanket out to set up like a picnic, right? It's not just like we throw out this big thing of structure and now everything's honky-dory, rainbows and butterflies. It doesn't work that way. What happens is we have to take all these interactions, all these situations, and provide structure in each one. You see? So this is almost like pieces of the puzzle. We have to put a couple pieces together over here, a couple over here, and here, and here, and here, and here. And eventually, you have the big puzzle made. For your dog, every time that you can provide a little bit of structure, you're removing a layer of stress. Now, think about how powerful that can actually be. Even if your dog is stressed in a certain situation, or maybe it's just stressed all the time, as the stress comes off your dog and you're the one that's taking the stress, removing the stress away, you become more valuable to your dog. So think about what's happening in that relationship now. I think mealtime is an overlooked training session that we have normally with our dogs twice a day, if you feed twice a day. So you getting the food ready, you putting the food down for them, it can be a 30-second to 3-minute training session that you're already doing. And so if your dog is super duper excited about feeding time, you can create structure around that. If your dog is super duper forward, like all up in your business while you're trying to prep the food, we can put structure to that. So to me, we're already getting the food ready, right? So this is one of those situations where I feel like I'm not adding on to your daily routine. I'm not giving you something extra that you have to do. You're already doing this. All I'm saying is maybe you add on an extra 30 seconds, minute, 2 minutes. That's it, right? So think about that. Even if I said, put in 2 extra minutes at each feeding time, that's 4 minutes of dog training a day. I mean, it's really nothing at all. Number two, I think it's important for the walk to be structured, but more importantly than that, and this is something that I've really been on my mind lately. I think too many people are struggling with their dog getting too excited before the walk. And so this is another situation where I think owners should provide a lot more structure to their dogs before going out for that walk. This is something, now you're probably not putting in a lot of time during this, because this is like I just got to get on my shoes, get my coat on if you're in the north, and grab the leash, hook Fido, and out we go. Meanwhile, Fido's bouncing all over the place. So now, if you're already walking your dog every day, look, here's something else that you can do for a couple extra minutes, okay? So now we're up to 6 minutes a day. So there's two situations that we can provide structure that we're removing some of that stress from our dog. Now, number three, of course, is taking your dog for a walk. The structure to take your dog for a walk. A lot of these dogs that are reactive towards certain stimulations, they actually come out of the house and they're scanning already. They're like, where's the movement? Where is the threat? Where is the thing that's probably gonna end my life? Because I have to do something about it. So they just don't ever stop scanning. They just keep looking and looking and looking, and that becomes the whole walk, is this looking. Number one, it's not healthy. And number two, it is tiring, because I will hear people say, by the time we come back home, he's exhausted. Well, yeah, because he's been basically hunting for who knows how long, for maybe a half an hour. Think about where he's got to be mentally to hunt for a half an hour. That's exhausting. So as much as we work on getting ready to go for the walk, we have to work on the walk itself. If you go for a 30-minute walk, I'm not asking you to add extra time to work onto your walk. I know, it's crazy. What I'm saying is, take those 30 minutes, that is your block of time. This is your 30 minutes to work with your dog. And so if you walk outside and your dog is starting to scan, I turn around and walk right back in. You see? So now we wait a second, wait for the dog to relax. From there, we turn around, we go right back out. If the dog starts scanning, we turn around and go right back in. So the start of the walk, actually, the 30 minutes, it actually starts when you either go to get your leash or get your shoes on and the dog realizes you're gonna go for a walk. That's when second one of the walk starts. So if you have to take 15 minutes of doing this doorway work in and out of your house to help prevent the scanning, you've only got 15 minutes left to walk. I'm not throwing any extra time onto your day. So eventually you keep repeating this process and the dog's gonna go out and be like, yeah, we're going back in. And then we go back out and then, yeah, we're gonna go back in. Great, so now you go out and the dog's not really doing much. It's like, okay, I guess we're not gonna go anywhere. That's when you decide to go forward. Do you see? So then we can extend this state of mind that you created inside, and now you're bringing it with you on the walk. Now you're creating more structure for your dog to follow. Again, removing another layer of stress from your dog. Removing another reason for them to hunt. Removing another reason for them to just sit there and track and try to find something that's moving. You've done your walk. You spent two extra minutes during feeding time. Maybe you spent two extra minutes before, during the excitement, before the walk. And then you went for the walk, you see? So I'm only asking you to add 4 minutes so far. And then feeding time at night, right? If it was your second feeding. So now we have 6 minutes total that we're adding to your day. If you can provide this kind of structure, now your dog knows what to expect from you. Not only do they know what to expect from you, but they know what to expect from you in a healthy way. I'm a firm believer that when dogs are born, they're almost born to a default, right? That this is who they are. If you've ever seen a mother with their young, she provides structure, but she also provides love and affection. Structure usually comes, is more powerful, if you will, because that's what creates the rules and the boundaries. Making sure that you get enough structure with your dog will help remove those layers of stress. So we talked about feeding time. We talked about getting ready to go for the walk, and we talked about the walk. Now let's talk about playtime, because this is important too. Now I want to create more structure during playtime. So we're going to take the game of fetch, for example, because there's a lot of people that just play fetch with their dogs. A lot of times they get to chuck it, they get the tennis ball, and it's like, woof, dog goes get it, brings it back, drops it. They pick it up, woof, same thing. Bring it back, pick it up, throw it again. Bring it back, pick it up, throw it again. And then this is just autopilot for your dog. There's nothing new. Nothing different here. This is like just almost, it can become obsessive if it's just done enough this way. Put your dog on a leash. You can get the chucket, you can get the tennis ball. Put your dog on a leash, hang on to it, throw the ball, and have your dog stay there next to you. Don't release them until there's slack in the leash and they're sitting down. The other thing too is for us in the north, if you throw a ball, we know right now, it's gonna disappear into the snow. And so the way it works with dogs is that they keep an eye on the last spot that they saw the ball when it disappeared. Once we cut them loose, they go to that spot and now they have to use their nose to find the ball. You see? So it's all eyes first, but when they get there, they gotta use their nose, especially if the ball actually tumbled in the snow at all. So great, now the dog brings it back, but you know what? Maybe it took 3 minutes for your dog to actually sit down on a leash and be polite before you actually cut them loose. In that time before, playing fetch before, you probably threw that ball at least 3 times in 3 minutes, at least. I wanna provide enough of that structure to where I'm actually gonna wear the dog out more by throwing it once in about 3 or 4 minutes than just the rapid fire over and over and over and over again. That's option number one. Option number two is to require a little bit more structure. Do the same thing, they bring it back, you pick it up, you have them on leash, you have them sit. Now we don't throw it until you're getting eye contact on a loose leash. So you see how we up the game a little bit? And so that gets repeated so the dog can come back. Now, I'm not talking about the dog that's just gonna sit there. He throws the ball at your feet. He sits back and he's just staring at you and he's wiggling and he's like, okay, go ahead and throw it, I'm so ready. No, that state of mind is up here, right? With the lunging dog. So this has to come down. It has to come down. Otherwise, you're nurturing this intensity, just nurturing, nurturing, nurturing. So for me, I would much rather work on the intensity, bring it back down, show the dog new rules of the game, and then eventually they can creep back up a little bit, but I'm gonna keep that under control. So let's say you play with your dog 10 minutes a day. Guess what? I'm not adding on any more time that you actually need to train your dog. You are actually training your dog within that same 10-minute time. And from there, you're actually making your dog work harder. So it's going to rest better, healthier, easier. And the game of fetch doesn't become as obsessive either. So all these things that I'm giving you, all of these scenarios right now, are ways that you can remove layers of stress from your dog. And dogs are creatures of habit, and we want to delve into that part with them. You see, and animals are creatures of habit. For me, I've got a lot of deer around my house. They're constantly walking in the same paths, especially in the snow, in the winter. You can see it. They're constantly in the same paths. They're creatures of habit. The more of a routine you can have with your dog, the better off you will be, especially if you have a stressful dog. Create a routine, you see? So now, what is the routine? The routine is a new feeding time. The routine is, I should say, a structured feeding time. The routine is structured before going for a walk. It's structured during the walk. It's structured playtime. And then if you actually to crate your dog after playtime, that's even another layer of structure that you can throw on. I hope you guys are understanding this. I hope you're getting it. There are a lot of stressed dogs out there. And unfortunately, I think we're going to see a lot more here in the next 6 to 10 months with things starting to open back up from COVID. Because a lot of these dogs that this generation, if you will, of COVID dogs have just been seeing this part of us for their entire lives. And then things are going to suddenly change. Well, I shouldn't say suddenly, but things are going to change to where all of a sudden now they get to see this. And that's a huge change for our dogs. And for dogs that have been around and got a little sketchy of the people with the masks. And then now they're going to start to be without the masks. And I think that's going to be a huge change for our dogs. So please do yourselves a favor. Do your dog a favor. Create structure. Create a routine. I just gave you a bunch of examples and all these different ways that you can do it. And it's only adding 6 minutes onto your day. 6 minutes with your dog. Imagine having a well-trained dog in 6 minutes, just doing 6 minutes a day. Beyond what you're already doing. If you're not doing any structure around feeding time and you're just filling the bowl and throwing it down, you got some work to do. Same thing if you're just hooking the leash and you're letting your dog pull you while they scan the landscape for a half an hour, you got some work to do. And if you're sitting there with the chuck it and you're just throwing it and throwing it and throwing it and throwing it, you got some work to do. Remember my post from last week, when we adopt a dog, their mental health should be priority number one. And nutrition. Those are kind of the two biggies. Look at how important that is for us. But when we adopt, it's mental health and nutrition. This should be the priority with our dogs. Mental health takes away that stress. The structure, the routine takes away the stress. I hope you guys got something out of this tonight. There's a lot to be said about stress. And there's a lot to be said about the positive and negative of how that stress can affect our dog. Let me know what you think. I would love to hear your comments. You guys have a great night. I'll catch you later.